Luke chapter 6 is where we're going to be today. And I thought, since it's Thanksgiving, by the way, I think Thanksgiving is one of the most Christian holidays we have. You don't see the Thanksgiving holiday in the Bible like you do the birth of Jesus. We celebrate that at Easter. I mean, at Christmas, and the death and resurrection of Jesus, we celebrate that Good Friday and Easter. And Thanksgiving, we know, is kind of an all-American holiday, started in American history, but there is the idea of being thankful all throughout Scripture. And God's people have much to be thankful for. Amen?
Amen.
And it is truly God's people who know who to say thank you to. We know the Bible says that God causes the rain to fall on the righteous and the wicked. The difference between a believer and a lost person is we know who to say thank you to. And so we're very grateful. And our hearts are full of thanksgiving this week as we set some time aside and say thank you for all that God has done. And I thought it would be fitting on Thanksgiving or the Sunday before Thanksgiving to preach a sermon to you on how to be rich. Now, I know that sounds a little counterproductive. It sounds a little strange. Well, good. I've got your attention. Now, I want to propose to you this morning that being rich has nothing to do with money. Nothing at all. Some of the poorest people in the world, as we would call them, are richer than we'll ever know. Now, what it means to be rich, it means this, to be content with what God has given you. If we can learn to be content with what God has given us, to be thankful for those things, and if we can be godly, friends, that's the secret to being rich. It has nothing to do with your bank account, has nothing to do with your retirement, has nothing to do with what kind of shoes you wear or what kind of purse you own or even if you're going to get that new, really, really terribly expensive iPhone X. I don't understand sitting out, camping out overnight. If you just give it a year, you'll be able to buy it for so much cheaper and still have money to do things with like you need to. So being rich, that is really the topic of this sermon, how to be rich. And it's kind of a play on words. I want you to be thinking about what it really means to be rich and how much we have to be thankful for. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Starting in verse 6, it says this, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." That's the main verse we're going to keep in mind today. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Paul goes on to say, "For we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction." Verse 10 says, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs." Verse 11 says, "But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses." What does it mean to be rich? I want to let you know this morning a few very simple things. The sermon is very simple. The sermon is going to be shorter than other sermons because it's very to the point. Paul says, in order to be rich or to have great gain, we need to have godliness. We must have godliness in our lives. Your main priority as a believer, and my main priority as a believer, is not to keep up with the rest of the world. It's not to accumulate stuff. It's not to have more in the bank account. It is to be godly. That is what we need to strive for. It means we need to have reverence of God. We need to put Him in His right place. We need to put ourselves in the right place. God is way up here, and we are not. We are down here. We bow the knee to Almighty King Jesus. Godliness is what we need. This also speaks of purity. Now, we have to have holiness in our lives. There needs to be a difference between us and other people that we know who do not know Jesus. Otherwise, where is Christ? Jesus Christ never leaves a person the same. We must have godliness, and we're never going to be rich, so to speak, without godliness. We're never going to be satisfied and have what we truly need if we do not have a relationship with God and live for His glory. Going hand in hand with godliness, Paul says, and contentment. Now, we have a problem with contentment in our society today. We all serve the God of more. More, more, more. Have you ever noticed that we're kind of like a goldfish? And, you know, I don't know a whole lot about goldfish, but I've heard that if you put one in one size tank, it'll get bigger, and then you put it in a bigger tank, it'll get bigger, and they kind of grow to keep up with their surroundings. We're kind of that way when it comes to stuff. Maybe you had a black and white TV at some point. I hope you didn't have to have one, but if you had to suffer through black and white TV, that was nice when it came out. Then it started making color TVs. You say, oh, I need to get a color TV. And you would never go back to black and white after you had color, unless you're going to watch the Andy Griffith Show or something like that. I love the Andy Griffith Show. And then they started making these other TVs, and big screen TVs, that were bigger than this pulpit. And probably thicker than this pulpit, too. And everybody had to have one of those. Now they're doing flat screen TVs. Now they're doing curved TVs. Now, did you ever notice they used to make TVs kind of curved this way? Then they made them flat, then they make them concave. We can't ever make out which is the best way to put a TV screen. We're never happy. You make your first job. I think my first job I made $6.35 an hour. For some of you, wow, your first job, you didn't make half of that. Times change and money changes, but $6.35 is peanuts nowadays. I thought I had everything. I got my first paycheck. I think I made $200. I worked 40-plus hours, I think, that week. I worked like a dog to get that $200. Nowadays, when I told my little sister, yeah, $6.35 is good money starting at, she'd laugh at me. People aren't going to work for less than $10 an hour nowadays, something I'll never be able to understand, but that's the way the world is. What I'm trying to say is, when you get your next job, you make a little more money, then suddenly, now you've got enough. You make a little more money, and so I can never go back to living in that income bracket. I need a little bit more. We're never happy. The more we make, the more we want. The bigger we have something, then we want something even bigger than that. We have a nice pair of shoes, and we want a nicer pair of shoes. We have a problem with being content. We all do. It's not that some people have a problem with this and some people don't. If we're honest with ourselves, at some point in some areas, we have a contentment problem. The most freeing thing you can ever do in this life besides trusting Jesus is to perhaps just be happy with what you have. Just be happy with what you have. You're not going to maybe drive a brand new Cadillac Escalade. That's okay. Drive what God's given you and be happy with it. You might not be able to have a $500 purse, ladies. It's okay. The one at Target looks just fine. Who probably can't tell the difference anyway? I know from experience. It is okay to have what you've been given. There's no shame in being happy with what God has seen fit to give you. You do not live to impress other people. You live for the glory of God. Amen. Be happy with what God's given you. If you can get that through your mind that I'm happy with godliness, and I know Jesus Christ, I'm saved, everything's okay in eternity, and God's given me everything I need now, and everything I have has been given by Him. Wow, what a great treasure that is. Have you ever been at a child's birthday party and seen that really embarrassing display where someone brings a gift, and you don't know the person too well, but they're friends of friends, so you know, they come because they feel like they have to, so they bring a gift for a child. And the kid opens the gift, and he says, I don't want this, I don't like this, that's not what I asked for. Well, I've got some strong opinions about what to do with that child, but anyway, the thing is, that's an embarrassing thing when a child opens a gift and complains about it, isn't it? It's uncomfortable. It makes you want to climb under the birthday cake table, grab the cake, and just sit in there and eat the cake and just hope it all goes away. At least that's what I think about doing anyway. Something is just very uncomfortable when a kid opens a gift and throws a fit about it. Well, if we're not careful, we can do the same thing. Whenever God gives us something, instead of being happy about it, thankful for it, proud of it, take it, you know, you take pride in what you have, keep it in good condition, praise God for it. Instead, we throw a fit and we say, well, that's not what I want. I want a different color. I want a different model. I wanted to make more. I wanted to have more. Just relax and be thankful for what you I think as we look at Thanksgiving, that's something we need to be able to say, God, thank you for what you've given me. By the way, most of us aren't doing what we want to do. Most of us aren't living what we want to live. Most of us don't own what we want to own. Many of us live in a fantasy world. We all have better than what we deserve. And that's the truth, if you know what I'm talking about. You all have better than what you deserve. All of us do. Verse 7, Paul says this. He continues making this argument. He says, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. That reminds me of what my mom would say, I brought you into this world, I can take you out of it. But there's some truth here, and what he's saying is absolutely true right here. He says, listen, you didn't bring anything into the world. That means this, everything you have has been given to you by somebody. There are no self-made men, there are no self-made women. You have it because God let you have it. There are some of us who get arrogant enough to say, well, I work hard, I earn this, I deserve this. Oh, yes, you work hard. But you can only do that because God gives you your health.
Amen.
Oh, I work hard at this job. You know how many people would love to have your job in this world? You have that job because God gave you that job because God let you have it. You didn't bring anything into this world, and you cannot take anything out of the world. Now, this is a sobering thought. It's a little bit depressing, but that's just the facts. We will spend our lives working to fill up our houses with stuff that our kids are going to give to the Salvation Army when we die.
Amen.
That sounds so terrible. Your children and grandchildren will save some of your stuff. The rest of it they're going to give to sell at an estate sale, or they're going to donate to Goodwill or Salvation Army. It's a brutal truth. And we have a hard time understanding that. It's been well said, you never see a U-Haul behind a hearse. You never see anybody going to their funeral and bringing all their stuff with them. You cannot bring anything out of this world. That causes us to ask ourselves a very important question. Well, what am I living my life for? What am I investing in? What am I really spending my time accomplishing here on this earth? If everything that I'm working for is just stuff or just money, that will not come with me in the afterlife. That will not come with me into heaven. And it certainly won't come with you to hell either. What is it really all about? It's about godliness. It's about contentment. You live a life for God's glory, you will leave a lasting mark on this world. Your children can spend all the inheritance that you leave them and still go to hell. But you teach them about God, you raise them in godliness, your influence will live on. You may even live on eternally. Your children may go to heaven. Your grandchildren may go to heaven. You leave them a pile of money and they can be like the prodigal son. Spend it all, and the next thing you know, they're eating with the pigs. It happens every day. Well, let's take a look at what he says in verse 8. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. In other words, that's really all you need to get by in this life. You do not need your cell phone. It's shopping, but you do not need that. You do not need a car. You don't. You know how many people live in this world without a car? I was talking to Dalton the other day. My brother is, most of you know, if not all, he's serving as a missionary in Southeast Asia. I said, Dalton, what's been the biggest change living over there? And he said, well, besides the normal stuff, I haven't driven in 3 months. He said, you can't drive over here. You just can't do that. He rides a bike, he walks. He says, when I get back to America, it'll be 2 years since I've driven. You can't drive. Everybody lives there fine without a car. And they're happy and they don't know what they're missing. You can live without a car. You can live without a computer. You can even live without a nice house. You can even live, dare I say, without air conditioning. Lord, may it never be. But if you have food and you have covering, really the Greek in there, clothing is more like the idea of covering. You have what you need in this life. And God's given every single one of you that because you look well fed. I'm not saying who, but we all look well fed, right? And we have clothes. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We have more than enough to get on our knees and say thank you, Jesus, for. We need to also have, if we're going to be rich, we need to have a right view of money. There is a dangerous thing about money. Money can trap you. There was a picture in my history book as a child. And growing up for fun, I would read history textbooks. That was a nerd. That's what I liked to do. The more history books I could find, the better. Read about American history, world history, Soviet history, all that stuff. I just love that stuff. Well, there is a picture from Nazi Germany of a lady who had a stove, and she was lighting a fire at her stove. And you know what she was lighting the fire, her wood-burning stove with?
Money.
A fistful of paper money, burning the money just to be able to stay warm and have food to eat. That picture has changed my life forever. Seeing that, you know, there are times when money doesn't matter. There are times when money does not make a lick of difference. And there are times where you may have to use money just to start a fire with. What we really need to understand is that money is just a tool. Money is just a tool. The only thing that makes money valuable is because that's what you buy food with. That's what you pay the bills with. But money can be a trap for so many people. Look at verse 9. But those who desire to be rich. Now, desiring to be rich is not the same as being content. Being content says, God, I'm happy with what you've given me. It doesn't mean we're lazy. It doesn't mean we sit around and say, well, I'm not going to work hard for a good living. No, work hard for a good living. Do what you can to provide for your family. It's okay to have nice things, but that's not what your life's all about. But the desiring to be rich is the problem. Some people live their lives just trying to be rich. There are many people who go to college, and they don't go to college to learn to do stuff that God's called them to do. They go in the field where they can make the most money. Now, if God calls you to a field where you're going to make lots of money, fine, so be it. But there are many people that God calls to do something that doesn't make a lot of money, but it's what He's called them to do, and they need to follow through with that. Those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Have you ever seen anybody's life ruined by money? I have. I've had a family member who's been a gambling addict. And he made a lot of money. A lot of money. I'm talking a lot. And when he died, there was no money for his family. He died suddenly, unexpectedly. There is no money for the family. Blew through the money and not be wise, was not wise with the money. Money will drive you crazy. The old saying goes, more money, more problems. That's about as true as it gets. Don't have a love of money. Look what it says in verse 10. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Now I have to clear this up. Money is not a root of evil. There's nothing wrong with money. There's nothing wrong with money any more than there's something wrong with fire. Fire is a great tool. But you can burn someone's house down with fire. You can die from fire. In the same way, money's a great tool. God blesses us with money. It takes money to even run the church. It does. When the lights are on, that doesn't happen for free. But the love of money, that's a whole other thing. This word, love of money, is one word in the Greek. It's the only time this word shows up in the Bible. Now, whenever you're doing studies in the Bible and you find a word that only shows up one time, that tells you something. That says that all the other words they could have written, they had to come up with this really focused and specialized word to show just how specific a problem they had. The word is love of money. What is wrong with the love of money? The Bible says it's a root of all kinds of evils, and that's true. It's not just that greed comes from a love of money. There's lots of things that happen from a love of money. There's corruption. There are affairs that take place. There's stealing. There's putting your family aside. There's not using your time wisely. There's idolatry that goes along with it. There are many people who worship the dollar more than Jesus Christ. The love of money is indeed a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving. Now, I think we're all familiar with what craving is. Some of us are craving this great lunch we're about to eat. Y'all, I have to tell you, I made an awesome peach cobbler. It weighs 5 pounds. I'm not even lying. I got my workout this morning bringing it across the park, and I'm thinking, man, this is great. Put one of these on, put one on each side of a bar and do curls, I'll be ripped in no time. We know what it means to crave, but it is wrong to crave money. It takes discipline to have money, to make money, to save money, to use money without craving money. That's the mark of being wise. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. You cannot be rich for money. You can be wealthy, maybe, but you cannot be rich. Being rich is much different than that. The final thing is this, before we close this morning. It seems like our lives are all about pursuing something. Have you ever noticed that? We're pursuing an education. We're pursuing a young lady. Before me and Mary got married, I was pursuing her. And I didn't have to pursue too hard, but she liked me too. And we're always pursuing something, it seems. Well, we need to understand what the right thing to pursue is. And you need to understand that pursuing the right thing will cause you to truly be rich. Look at verse 11. But as for you, O man of God, or woman of God, flee these things. Flee what? Flee the love of money. Just get away from that. Get away from the trap. Get away from this road that leads to destruction. Get away from not being content. Get away from not being godly. Run away from those things. And then he says, pursue this. Pursue what? Pursue righteousness. Pursue godliness and faith and love and steadfastness and gentleness. If you have those things in your life and you're pursuing the right thing, that's what we need to be pursuing. Not more money, more godliness. That's what the purpose of our life is. Not more money, more godliness. And it's when you become more satisfied with who God is and what He has given you, that your thanksgiving will abound and you'll realize, I'm so rich. I have so much that God's given me. Oh, the fact that I'm saved, praise God. The fact that I have a family, praise God. The fact that I got to eat today, praise God. The fact that I can go and open up a bottle of Tylenol and take a pill when I have a headache, praise God. Little things we need to understand, praise God. Thank you, God, for what you've given me. Being rich is not about getting more and more. Being rich is being thankful for what you've been given. And you cannot do that if you're not pursuing God. Verse 12, he says, fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of eternal life. This speaks of salvation. When does eternal life start? It's not when you die, it's when you're saved. I'm living now, I'm never going to die again. My body will die, but I won't. I'm living now, and I will live forever in heaven with Jesus Christ. Fight the good fight. Take hold of eternal life. This is what it means to be rich. On this Thanksgiving, I want to strongly, strongly encourage you, take some time in silence. And don't let the bank statement stress you out. November and December, we're all poor. Let's just call it what it is. November, December, January, we're all poor. That's just what it comes down to. The bigger your family gets, the poorer you get. You got more Christmas presents, you got more turkeys, you got more hams, you got all kinds of stuff. Don't worry about that. Take care of your business. Honor God with that. But get on your knees and praise God for what you have. Godliness with contentment, that's great. That's what it means to be rich. We're going to pray together, and we're also going to bless the food. And I want to let you know that if you have anything you want to pray about or talk about after the service, I'll be here for you. I'll be happy to listen to you. Let's pray. Father, we come to you and we say thank you for what you've given us. Lord, let us be godly. And let us be content with what we've been given. Let us be content with Jesus Christ. If nothing else, if we have you, is that not enough? Lord, if we were put on a desert island with no food, no water, no shelter, but we had Jesus, that would be enough. Lord, help our hearts to agree with that. Help our hearts to be content with who you are. Let us get the right perspective on possessions and money and understand that they're blessings and they're great things to have, but it's not what life's all about. It's about godliness and it's about being content. Thank you for salvation in Jesus Christ. Thank you for forgiving our sins and giving us new life. Thank you for our family and our friends and our church family. Lord, thank you for the lunch we're about to receive. Father, we do say thank you. Even though we had people who cooked that lunch and who worked hard to set the gym up and put tables and chairs and decorations and clean the gym and all those great things, we know ultimately came from you. You gave us the food. You gave us the people to do it with. Lord, help us to put everything back to you, to give you all credit. It's in Jesus' name we pray, for his glory. Amen.
Amen.
I want to let you know.